The Harvey Weinstein effect is real. At the beginning of October, the New York Times published a story in which numerous women, both named and anonymous, accused the now former Weinstein Company head of serial sexual harassment and assault. In the weeks that have followed, the allegations against Weinstein have increased exponentially as scores of women have come forward with allegations about other powerful men in entertainment and media, including director James Toback, who has been accused of harassment or assault by more than 200 women. Toback has denied the claims, while Weinstein has denied any non-consensual encounters. Though much of this behavior has reportedly been going on for years, the reaction to their alleged actions in the wake of Weinstein's downfall has been swift and decisive since the first Weinstein story broke. Numerous men have lost prominent positions in the industry due to allegations of sexual misconduct or a history of behavior that demeaned women. The list includes Amazon's Roy Price, NBC's Mark Halperin, and Nickelodeon's Chris Savigno. Others, like Toback, former Fox News host Bill O'Reilly, and photographer Terry Richardson, have been dropped by their agents and lost lucrative relationships with major industry players as a result of allegations. Here is a list of the men who have felt the Weinstein effect, which will be updated if and when necessary. Andy Signori. On October 6, one day after the initial Weinstein report was published in the Times, Defy Media announced that it was suspending Screen Junkies creator Andy Signori following allegations of sexual harassment from at least 5 women, including a former intern who said that Signori told her he wanted to masturbate in front of her, and one allegation of attempted assault from YouTuber April Dawn. On October 8, Defy fired Signori, saying, "There is simply no justification for this egregious and intolerable behavior." In August, Defy's HR team was made aware of allegations made against Andy, at which time an investigation was launched. On Friday, new information became available and the scope and magnitude of his inappropriate actions became apparent. "We are acting swiftly to address the concerns of the people affected, and that going forward, our community is free of harassment or discrimination of any kind." Signori has not yet publicly commented on the allegations, though the Screen Junkies team did address the allegations and their fallout in a video posted October 27, titled, "What Happened? What's Next? This was news that was a shock to all of us," says producer Dan Murrell in the video. "Andy was, for I think everyone here, not just our boss, but someone that we counted as a friend. And we found out overnight that he was not a person that we knew or that we thought he was." Roy Price. On October 12, 2 days after the New Yorker published its bombshell piece in which more than a dozen women accused Weinstein of harassment and assault, and actresses including Gwyneth Paltrow and Angelina Jolie went on the record about Weinstein in a separate New York Times story, producer Issa Hackett accused Amazon Studios chief Roy Price of harassing her in a cab during San Diego Comic-Con in 2015. Hackett says Price propositioned her and told her, "You will love my dick." She told The Hollywood Reporter that she was inspired to tell her story by the other women who have been far braver than I am, who have come forward about Weinstein. The same day Hackett went on the record, Price was suspended from Amazon. 5 days later, he officially resigned. Price declined THR's request for comment. Lockhart Steele. According to The All, the Vox Media editorial director was alluded to in an October 12 viral Medium post written by former Vox employee Eden Rowatensky, which alleged misconduct by several employers and co-workers, including one of the company's VPs, whom she said touched her and kissed her neck while she rode in a car full of co-workers after a company party. On October 19, Vox terminated Steele after he admitted engaging in conduct that is inconsistent with our core values and will not be tolerated at Vox Media, according to a statement from Vox Media CEO Jim Bankoff. Chris Savino. Several women alleged that the animator and creator of the Nickelodeon cartoon Loud House had sexually harassed them, reportedly offering work in exchange for sexual favors and sending lewd text messages, according to a report published October 17 in Cartoon Brew. Nickelodeon subsequently suspended Savigno, then fired him October 19. "I am deeply sorry and ashamed," Savigno wrote in a Facebook message 4 days after he was fired. "Although it was never my intention, I now understand that the impact of my actions and communications created an unacceptable environment. At every stage of my career, I have sought to uplift my colleagues and cultivate a culture of respect. In this objective, I have failed. I should have known better, I should have acted better, and this has been a difficult but valuable lesson. John Beesh. On October 21, the New Orleans Times-Picayune published a report in which 25 women accused the celebrity chef, a former Top Chef Masters contestant and host of Chef John Beesh's Family Table, of fostering a culture of sexual harassment at his restaurants. One woman accused Beesh of assaulting her when she was drunk. Beesh characterized the incident as a consensual relationship with one member of my team. On October 25, Beesh stepped down from his restaurant group to provide his full focus on his family, according to Shannon White, the new chief executive officer of Beesh Restaurant Group. I have been seeking to rebuild my marriage and come to terms with my reckless actions given the profound love I have for my wife, my boys, and my Catholic faith, Beesh said in a statement October 23. I also regret any harm this may have caused to my second family at the restaurant group, and sincerely apologize to anyone, past and present, who has worked for me who found my behavior as unacceptable as I do. James Tabak. On October 22, the Los Angeles Times published a piece in which 38 women, 31 of whom have gone on the record, accused the Oscar-nominated director and screenwriter of harassment and assault. Days later, the number of accusers climbed into the hundreds. On October 26, actresses Selma Blair and Rachel McAdams came forward with their own harrowing stories about Tabak, saying that he targeted them when they were in their 20s and promised jobs and advice in exchange for sexual favors. In the wake of the scandal, Tabak has been dropped by his agent, Jeff Berg. When contacted by Vanity Fair, Tabak declined to comment on Blair and McAdams' allegations previously. When contacted by the LA Times for its initial story, Tabak told reporter Glenn Whip that he had never met any of these women or, if he did, it was for 5 minutes and have no recollection. He also repeatedly claimed that for the last 22 years, it had been biologically impossible for him to engage in the behavior described by the women in this story, saying he had diabetes and a heart condition that required medication. Tabak declined to offer further details. Dan Katz and PFD. Commenter. On October 23, ESPN cancelled a series called Barstool Van Talk after a single episode. The show, hosted by Katz and the pseudonymous PFD. Commenter, who also co-hosts the Barstool Sports Blog's Pardon My Take podcast, had come under fire primarily for a 2014 Barstool Sports post about ESPN personality Sam Ponder, which called the sportscaster a bible-thumping freak and a chick that has a job where the number one requirement is you make men hard, effective immediately. I am cancelling Barstool Van Talk, ESPN president John Skipper said in a statement. While we had approval on the content of the show, I erred in assuming we could distance our efforts from the Barstool site and its content. Katz and PFT responded that they were heartbroken by the decision, with Katz adding on Twitter, "I'm obviously beyond heartbroken, but if you know me, Hank, and PFT, you know we won't stay down from this for long." PFT, meanwhile, tweeted, "Welp. Time to get drunk." Terry Richardson. On October 24, Condé Nast, which publishes magazines including Vogue, GQ, and Vanity Fair, formally severed ties with Richardson, a prolific photographer who has long been accused of misconduct, including allegedly getting naked during photo shoots and pressuring unwilling models to pose suggestively. He denied the allegations in 2014, calling them nothing more than an emotionally charged witch hunt. Terry is disappointed to hear about this email, especially because he has previously addressed these old stories, a spokesperson for Richardson told Time. He is an artist who has been known for his sexually explicit work, so many of his professional interactions with subjects were sexual and explicit in nature, but all of the subjects of his work participated consensually. Leon Vizetier, the longtime New Republic editor, who left the magazine in 2014, was reportedly included on a crowdsourced list of so-called shitty media men that circulated October 11. Vizetier was accused of making sexually charged comments to colleagues, according to an October 26 Splinter story. During his New Republic days, an anonymous co-worker once put a sign in Vizetier's office that said, "Warning, a registered sex offender lives here." On October 24, Emerson Collective, a company backed by Laureen Powell Jobs, severed its ties with Vizetier, with whom it had been collaborating on a new magazine. "For my offenses against some of my colleagues in the past, I offer a shaken apology and ask for their forgiveness," Vizetier said in a statement. "The women with whom I worked are smart and good people. I am ashamed to know that I made any of them feel demeaned and disrespected. I assure them that I will not waste this reckoning. Mark Halperin. On October 26, CNN published a story in which five women accused Halperin, a prominent journalist, author, and TV political analyst, of harassing them when he held the previous position at ABC News. "I went up to have a soda and talk and he just kissed me and grabbed my boobs," one woman said. "I just froze. I didn't know what to do." Others said that a clothed Halperin had forcibly pressed his erect penis against them. Halperin responded with a statement: "During this period, I did pursue relationships with women that I worked with, including some junior to me. I now understand from these accounts that my behavior was inappropriate and caused others pain. For that, I am deeply sorry and I apologize. Under the circumstances, I'm going to take a step back from my day-to-day work while I properly deal with this situation." Shortly after the story went, NBC News announced that it had severed ties with Halperin, while HBO nixed its plan to develop a movie about Halperin's forthcoming book about the 2016 election. Previously, the network produced a film version of Halperin and co-author John Heilman's book about the 2008 election, Game Change. Rick Nahara. On October 26, CBS severed ties with Rick Nahara, a writer and producer who spent 13 years heading up the network's annual diversity sketch comedy showcase, which focuses on providing exposure, access, and opportunities for talented and motivated diverse writers and performers, according to the network. The previous week, the network learned that Nahara had allegedly harassed performers in 2009 and 2014. In March 2017, CBS became aware of inappropriate comments made during the production of the Diversity Comedy Showcase, and remedial action was taken at that time, which the company felt was appropriate to the matter, a CBS spokesman told Variety. Subsequent information has recently emerged. After looking into these reports in a discussion with Mr. Nahara, he has resigned from his role with the Diversity Comedy Showcase. A representative for Nahara declined comment. Bill O'Reilly. Months after being fired from Fox News following a New York Times investigation that revealed Fox News had paid millions to women who had complained about O'Reilly's conduct over the years, the former O'Reilly Factor host was dropped by his literary agency, following the Weinstein scandal, and another Times report October 21 about another settlement O'Reilly paid right before Fox News renewed his final contract in January. O'Reilly has denied all accusations of sexual harassment and misconduct. The end game is, let's link Bill O'Reilly with Harvey Weinstein and take him out of the marketplace forever, he said on Glenn Beck's radio show October 23. We no longer represent Bill O'Reilly for future the deals, William Morris Entertainment announced October 26. It is our fiduciary responsibility to service the existing deals we have under contract, but we will not be working with him moving forward. O'Reilly has not responded to being dropped by WME, though he did respond to the latest Times story on his website, saying, in part, you know, am I mad at God? Yeah, I'm mad at him. I wish I had more protection. I wish this stuff didn't happen. I can't explain it to you. Yeah, I'm mad at him. Get Vanity Fair's HWD newsletter. Sign up for essential industry and award news from Hollywood. Full screen photos. 13 horror movies for wimps. Beckhaus. Nothing says horror like a 1920 German expressionist film. This classic about a murderous hypnotist is inspiring now for its groundbreaking cinematography and sheer artfulness, more of a gorgeous film noir than a real horror story. Photo from Everett Collection. The original cinematic adaptation of Bram Stoker's novel is a must-see for film fans. It's the mother of all vampire movies, featuring an indelible performance by Bela Lugosi and some really lush cinematography. This scene alone of Dracula's wife's awakening is a thing of pure beauty. Plus, it's from the 1930s, there's no way it'll scare you. Photo from Everett Collection. Ah, yet another classic that all film fans should have in their back pocket. The seminal Alfred Hitchcock thriller shocked audiences in 1960 with its jarring shower scene and ultimate plot twist, but it won't horrify modern viewers the same way. Hitchcock was more about suspense than jump scares, even if Psycho still gives you a healthy bout of chills. Photo from Paramount. Cobble Wreck Shutterstock. Speaking of old movies that aren't scary scary by modern standards, Brian De Palma's adaptation of this Stephen King novel about a bullied high school girl with a zealous mother is yet another standard bearer that scared people at the time of its release. Now it's got a sort of hokey 70s aesthetic that won't spook viewers more accustomed to sophisticated special effects. Photo from United Artists. Cobble Wreck Shutterstock. This stop-motion kids comedy is a joyful story about a boy who sees dead people. For the scary version, go The Sixth Sense. It's more of a delightful coming-of-age tale with genuine laughs, and some spooky animated creatures for good measure. Photo from Focus Feature Separate Collection. Much like Shaun, this 2014 mockumentary flips a genre on its head, poking fun at the wild and sexy lore of vampires. Written and directed by New Zealand's finest, Jermaine Clement and Taika Waititi, who also star, the film is about a trio of vampires just living everyday life, splitting house chores, trying to get invited into nightclubs, which takes a turn when they have to take in a new 20-year-old vampire. Photo from movie store Shutterstock. Make no mistake, Jordan Peele's excellent debut feature is a horror movie through and through, with highly unsettling twists and turns. But the horror doesn't rely on twisted jump scares or unsightly violence. Instead, it's baked into the film's brilliant social commentary on modern racism. And if that's not enough, take it from another wimp, this is a horror hit you can handle. Photo from Universal Everett Collection.